processional hymn this morning is 493, Oh, for a Thousand Tongues to Sing. Why don't we do four verses since it's so short?
We say, "Save, O Lord, your people, the remnant of Israel. See, I am going to bring them from the land of the north and gather them from the farthest parts of the earth. Among them, the blind and the lame, those with child and those in labor, together a great company, they shall return here. With weeping they shall come, and with consolations I will lead them back. I will let them walk by brooks of water in a straight path in which they shall not stumble. For I have become a father to Israel, and Ephraim is my firstborn." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let's recite the psalm responsively, alternating verses. When the Lord restored the fortunes of Zion, then were we like those who dream.
Then was our mouth filled with laughter, and our tongue with shouts of joy.
Then they said among the nations, "The Lord has done great things for them."
The Lord has done great things for us, and we are glad indeed.
Restore our fortunes, O Lord, like the watercourses of Negev.
Those who sow with tears will reap with songs of joy.
Those who go out weeping, carrying the seed, will come again with joy, shouldering their sheaves.
Our second lesson today is from Paul's letter to the Hebrews. The former priests were many in number because they were prevented by death from continuing in office. But Jesus holds priesthood permanently because he continues forever. Consequently, he is able for all time to save those who approach God through him, since he always lives to make intercession for them. For it was fitting that we should have such a high priest, holy, blameless, undefiled, separated from sinners, and exalted above the heavens. Unlike the other priests, he had no need to offer sacrifices day after day, first for his own sins, and then for those of the people. This he did once for all when he offered himself. For the law appoints as high priest those who are subject to weakness, but the word of the oath, which came later than the law, appoints a son who has been made perfect forever. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The sequence hymn this morning is number 773 in the green hymnal, "Heal Me, Hands of Jesus." We'll sing verses 1, 2, and 3 before the gospel, and then verse 4 after the gospel. "Jesus, son of David,
have mercy on me. Many sternly ordered him to be quiet, but he cried out even more loudly, Son of David, have mercy on me. Jesus stood still and said, Call him here. And they called the blind man, saying to him, Take heart, get up, he is calling you. So throwing off his cloak, he sprang up and came to Jesus. Then Jesus said to him, What do you want me to do for you? The blind man said to him, My teacher, let me see again. Jesus said to him, Go, your faith has made you well. Immediately he regained his sight and followed him on the way. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
In the name of the living God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Please be seated. Bartimaeus, the son of Timaeus, that's all his name means. Bart means son of. Bartimaeus, the blind man, is healed in today's account. Is it simply a healing miracle? Demonstrating yet again that Jesus is identified with the Holy One of Israel, controlling the chaos and lifting that which would thwart God's creation, such as blindness. Is it simply that it? If we take the story as it stands alone, is that all it's saying? Well, the story falls within a chapter. And for those of us who can remember the past few Sundays, they're all thread together. What happened last week? Do you remember the sons of Zebedee, James and John? They approach Jesus. And Jesus asked them the same question he asked Bartimaeus. What is it that you want me to do for you? Do you remember what the sons of Zebedee said? We want to sit at your right and left hand when you come into glory. Yeah. What does Bartimaeus ask for? He wants to see again. Already we've got a contrast here. Now, go back 2 weeks when the rich young man approached Jesus and said, What must I do to inherit eternal life? That's the bottom story. I mean, they said, Well, you know the commandments, love your parents, you know, don't murder. And he said, Well, I've done all this. And he says, Well, you lack one thing. Sell your possessions and give the money to the poor and come follow me. And what happened? The rich young man went away sad because he had many possessions. Sad indeed. And we are contrasted here with Bartimaeus. What do we know about Bartimaeus? Very little, but there are a few key elements. He's a blind beggar. What do we know about blind people?
They can't see.
Do we treat them special? Well, we do a better job than in the days of Jesus, right? We've actually got like White Cane Day and different appreciation, and we educate people on their situation. But in the days of Jesus, if you were struck with a physical illness, how was that interpreted? It's your fault. In the Gospel of John, they ask Jesus, who sinned with regard to a blind man? Who sinned, this man or his parents? Because obviously it's a punishment. So many people thought like that. So he isn't, let's just say, treated with much respect. He's on the margins, and he's a beggar. That's all he's allowed to do. That's all he can do. And what is the descriptive, what does he do when he is called by the crowd to go see Jesus? What does he do? Will you pay attention? He takes off his cloak. Why should that even be included? And Linda Tabbitt was called to meet Jesus and she threw off her cardigan sweater. It'd be meaningless, right? But why the cloak? Why the cloak? And this is, I swear, it's, even if I knew this, it struck me as really interesting, if not explaining so much. In the book of Deuteronomy, that's in the Hebrew scriptures, right after Exodus, the Jewish people are instructed that you cannot take a beggar's cloak because that's all they have. That's their house. That's their sole possession. It kept, that was their coat. It was their blanket. It was their house. It was their sleeping bag. They didn't own property. They were sleeping out in the open. And the cloak was what protected them from the elements. And if you were to take their cloak as a pledge, you had to promise to return it to them by nightfall so that they'd have a place to sleep. That was the teaching of Deuteronomy. So when Bartimaeus gets up and he throws his cloak to the ground to go meet Jesus, and there's never any reference that he goes back to get his cloak. That's his sole possession. And he has left it behind. To do what? To follow Jesus on the way. And that's what the early church described discipleship as, the way of Jesus, the way of discipleship, the way of the cross. Bartimaeus has thrown his sole possession aside. He wasn't like the rich young man who could have chosen which ones to get rid of. He threw away his sole possession to follow Jesus. Now, it's not just a story about healing, is it? It's a contrast or foil to those two preceding stories. He asks for sight as opposed to glory, and he gives up everything to follow Jesus, unlike the rich young man. So, what shall we do? Shall we throw away everything we own to follow Jesus? No? Why not? A lot of the scripture is symbolic. What are we holding on to that we don't let go of in order to follow Jesus?
Compassion?
Are you holding on to compassion, Linda? Stop picking on me! First it was a sweater. No, and I was really thinking about this from our open, for the sequence here. Heal me, hands of Jesus, and search out all my pain. Restore my hope, remove my fear, and bring me peace again. What do we carry around in our life?
Stuff.
What kind of baggage do we carry around? Hurt?
Fear.
Resentment? Fear? I got a whole tourister set of baggage crammed with bitterness and fear. Father Bittermore, what? Yes, I have fully packed resentment in my luggage. And I know I'm not alone. Have you ever been slighted by anyone? Have you ever been put down? Have you ever been neglected? Indeed you have, and I probably did half of it. So, but we hang on to the hurts, don't we? We cloak ourselves in pain. Can we throw it aside like Bartimaeus? Can we let it go? Easier said than done. But Bartimaeus still shows us the way. Let it go. Let it go. Can we do it? Let's try. Amen.
Amen.
Let us stand and reaffirm our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, "Peace I give to you, my own peace I leave with you. Regard not our sins, but the faith of your church, and give to us the peace and unity of that heavenly city, where with the Father and the Holy Spirit you live and reign, now and forever."
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Peace, Winthrop.
Please be seated. So everyone join us for coffee hour. I hear there's going to be some blueberryness.
Blueberryness and scotch.
And scotch. All right. Come on over for coffee hour. Let's see, what's coming up? Well, today is the last Sunday we're collecting for St. Mark's education program. And then next month, we'll be focusing on pie in the sky. We won't be collecting for it per se, but that's where we're going to focus our energies. There's a blurb in the bulletin on that. So Dave Pfeiffer is going to be coordinating that. So if you have questions, contact him. And, well, you know, we've gotten through one fair. That means what's on the horizon, Donna?
The Snowflake Fair!
The Snowflake Fair! Now, I saw something about an organizational meeting. When will that be?
Wednesday at 7.
Here in the hall?
Yeah.
All right. Okay, someone said to me, I think it's Monday. I said, I checked that date. all right. What else is coming up? Anything?
Daylight savings time. Yeah.
Daylight savings time. Now, I don't know if you noticed this morning, it was still pretty dark at 7. My dogs don't seem to notice, however. I thought they did. So, next weekend, sleep in a bit. Fall back. Yeah, and then be prepared to have pitch darkness at 5:01.
Yes.
So put on your bunny slippers earlier, put on your bathrobe, and crash on the couch. 5:02. So are there any other announcements? Have I forgotten anything? Next week is the brunch, and we've got the diocesan convention. I know Dee Dee registered. Viking, have you registered? Your light so shine before others that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father in heaven.
Thank you.
Bobby DeBonis, and Bill Murphy. And our worship continues with prayer B, as found in your program. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. For by water and the Holy Spirit, you made us a new people in Jesus Christ, our Lord, to show forth your glory in all the world. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Blessed are those who are called to his supper.
Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but only say the words, and I shall be healed.
Peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be amongst you and remain with you always.
Amen.
Our recessional hymn this morning is number 535, Ye Servants of God.